to praise the Lord tonight. Yeah. You're the earth beneath my feet. Oh, I'm standing on a promise so sweet. Yeah, your word is etched on my heart, and there's nothing that can wipe away these permanent marks.
With heaven we sing, cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down.
Oh, praise, oh, praise the name. Father, we praise your name tonight because we're expectant. We believe, God, that you can do miraculous things in our lives tonight, God. And God, we just want to get our hearts prepared right now for all you want to do. I believe, God, you want to bring healing to people's lives. You want to bring financial miracles tonight. You want to bring relationships back together and bridge things in their lives. So, Father, we give everything to you tonight. We're expectant and we're ready to receive in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, I was reading Matthew chapter 20, verses 29 through 34. And was talking about how Jesus was coming out of Jericho with his disciples and a crowd of people. And as he was coming out, he was walking alongside the road, and there were two blind men sitting on the side of the road. And all of a sudden, they began to cry out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus, kind of acting like he didn't hear, but he probably did, right? They say it again, even louder, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me." And then Jesus asks an interesting question. He turns to him and he says, "What do you want me to do for you?" And immediately they said, "That we may have sight." And Jesus, having compassion on him, what he did is immediately he healed them and sight was restored to their lives. It was interesting he asked him, "What do you want?" Because he knew they were blind. But he asked them that question, and what if, you know, maybe in their lack of faith and sometimes where we find ourselves, instead of asking God for Jesus for sight, they said, "You know, Lord, if you can just give me a cane so I can get around and walk. I can make my way through crowds. Or if you can give me a wheelchair or give me some help and assistance." Instead, they received the healing because they told him what they wanted. And I wonder tonight, how many times where Jesus is asking us, "What do you want?" And we're asking for a cane instead of asking for a miracle. We're asking for a wheelchair instead of asking for sight. I think Jesus is asking this question tonight as you come forward and as we pray with you. He's asking you, "What do you want? Do you have the faith to believe and ask for the miracle tonight that you want to get? Are you asking for a cane? Or are you asking for a wheelchair? Or are you asking for a miracle? Are you asking for him to give you sight?" Because I believe he wants to meet you right here. How many believe that tonight? Amen? So our prayer partners are going to come right now. And if you have any need tonight, they want to meet with you right here and pray with you. The rest of you may be seated. But if you'll come right now, they would love to pray with you. God bless you.
Tomorrow will bring, but I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? As I walk now through the valley, let your love rise above every fear. Like the sun shaping shadow in my weakness. All you are, will you meet?
of you glad that nothing can shake us? As a matter of fact, let's just say that nothing can shake me. Nothing can break me because I'm surrounded by the God of the universe. If you believe that, give one more shout of praise. Amen. You may be seated. We are so glad that you chose to join us on this beautiful day. This is a Wednesday, 40 days before Easter. So isn't that awesome? It's just a good time to remember that we're entering the Lent season. So how many of you are visiting with us? If you're visiting, if you don't mind, just stand and let us greet you. If you don't mind, just stand and let us greet you. We are so glad you came. You're our special guest. Welcome. Met some friends from Albuquerque that are here. So, hey, listen, don't forget this weekend, too. John Gray's going to be speaking for us. And I think it's the weekend that we spring forward, so don't forget about that, or else otherwise you'll come to church at the wrong time. Hey, let me, as the ushers come and we prepare to receive the offering, let me just, amen, we're cheerful givers here at Lakewood. Let me just read a couple of scriptures that are very familiar, but I found a new translation. Actually, Lisa showed it to me. It's called the Passion Translation. And just listen to the words of Matthew 6, Jesus' words. He says this: examine your motives to make sure you're not showing off when you do your good deeds, only to be admired by others. Otherwise, you will lose your reward of your Heavenly Father. So when you give to the poor, or when you give. So when you give, don't announce it and make a show of it just to be seen by people like the hypocrites in the streets and in the marketplace. They have already received their reward. But when you demonstrate generosity, do it with pure motives and without drawing attention to yourself. Listen to this. Give secretly, and your Father, who sees all that you do, will reward you openly. Isn't that beautiful? So listen, I want you to think about when you give this tithe or these offerings tonight, you're doing it secretly. But you have the assurance of the God of the universe. If you're doing it with the right motives, with a generous spirit and a pure heart, you know what? The reward that you have, God says He will reward you openly for what you've done. And listen, how many of you know if we give money, God will give money back to us? So He's our provider. He's our loving Heavenly Father. And then look, the bottom of that passage, that chapter says this. Very familiar, but listen to it in these words. Don't keep hoarding for yourselves earthly treasures that can be stolen by thieves. Material wealth eventually rusts and decays and loses its value. Instead, stockpile heavenly treasures for yourselves that cannot be stolen and that will never rust, decay, or lose their values. Now listen to this. For your heart will always pursue what you value as your treasure. Let me say that again. Your heart will always pursue what you value as your treasure. How many of you know that God's our treasure? And if we're going to pursue Him, you know what? Let's sow into the kingdom and we'll have treasures in heaven. And that shows that we're honoring God and we treasure Him as first in our life. Amen. Father, thank you for the opportunity to give. Father, bless my brothers and sisters as they give. Father, for those with financial needs, I pray, Father, that you would show yourself strong as their provider, Father. Father, I just pray that you would just provide even tonight, Father, even this week, Father, supernaturally, exceeding abundantly above anything that they could ask, think, or imagine. So, Father, as we give these tithes and offerings, we do it secretly, and we are anticipating you rewarding us openly, Father, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Let's welcome my sister Lisa.
Hey, hey. Thank you. Hey, Paul, let's tell them, when are you gonna be going again to Africa?
Next Monday.
Next Monday.
Yeah, okay. A week from Monday.
Yeah. Let's just stretch our hands out toward Him. Father, we thank you for touching Paul. We thank you, Father, that he goes in your name. We send him out, Father. We thank you that you're watching over him. You're protecting him, Father. You will use him greatly. You will give him wisdom, Father. And you will just cause him to meet the right people, to have divine opportunities, Father, and save many lives, Father, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Amen. We'll see you. It's awesome. How are y'all doing tonight? Y'all giving away all your money? Just kidding you. I'm ready to hear the Word of God. How about you? Or to get into the Word of God, I should say. So good to have all of you here. And the first-time visitors, we just welcome you tonight. And we just pray that you'll be blessed. If you'd like to open your Bibles, you can turn to Job chapter 5. If you don't know where Job is, it's right before the book of Psalms. and which is sort of in the middle of your Bible. Did you know that? Psalms is sort of in the middle of your Bible, so you can always use that as direction. But we're going to read a scripture from Job 5 in just a moment. As you turn there, I just want to mention to you that you can always down my full outline at lakewoodchurch.com or lisaosteencomas.com. That way you won't worry about trying to get all the scriptures and all the points, because sometimes I know I give a lot and I go a little fast sometime, and so that's why I do it for you, so you can have it and read back over it, so you can do that. I'm excited about tonight because I want to talk to you about unusual miracles. That's just stirring in my spirit. It's been in my heart for about a week and a half now. I was speaking at, just took a moment to speak at the pastor's conference we had here, and as I was speaking, the Holy Spirit just began to speak to me, and that came out of me. God was going to do unusual things and unusual miracles, and then I've just been meditating on that, and I've been thinking about it, and so I know that God is stirring us to see more miracles. I know that He wants to do more in our midst, and I don't know all He wants to do, but I just want to encourage you to start praying for miracles, to start expecting miracles, and start believing God for more miracles in our lives. Hey, you don't have to stay stuck where you are, amen? You don't have to stay in the same place. And I just believe that God wants to display His power among His people. And so I just, as I was studying this week, the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. And can I just read to you what I felt like He said to me? It's like a word of prophecy. And this is what I felt He said. God said, "I am a miracle working God. If my people would but believe and perceive who I really am. I am the one who made the sun stand still for Joshua. I parted the Red Sea for Moses. I caused water to come out of a rock. How much more will I do miracles for you, says the Lord? I desire to display my power to this generation." And that's what's stirring in my spirit. God wants to do miracles for you. He wants to do miracles for your children. Amen. And not only that, He wants to do miracles for the people you know, because He's going to use you to bring miracles to people. So I just want to encourage you to begin to exercise your faith for the miraculous. Let's live in the miraculous. Amen. God does the most amazing things when our circumstances seem hopeless, when they seem too far gone. God is well able to do a miracle. And so I was thinking about these unusual miracles, and I just looked up the word unusual. We use it all the time, but that word means this: notable, outstanding, unparalleled, and unprecedented. I believe God's going to do some notable miracles for you. Some unprecedented miracles for you. And when you think about it, the Bible, it is full of God's miracles. And what God did in the Bible, He wants to do for us today. And when you think about it, the miracles in the Bible that are recorded, there's healing miracles. There's financial miracles. There's relationship miracles. There's miracles for people who can't have children. Every person mentioned in the Bible that was barren, God opened their womb and they bore children. There's all kind of miracles in the Bible. Listen, there are physical miracles that defy the laws of nature, like when God parted the Red Sea. Who does that? It defies the laws of nature. When Jesus got up and He calmed the storm. See, that was such a miracle. People were raised from the dead. In the Bible, God caused one time a donkey to talk to a rebellious prophet. He caused a donkey to talk to Balaam. His name was Balaam. And He caused him to talk to him to stop him because he was trying to oppose and sort of curse the people of God. And God wasn't going to let him do that. And He caused a donkey to talk to that prophet. Listen, if He can cause a donkey to talk, He can give you a miracle. Amen. And it just shows me that God knows how to take care of our enemies. Amen. He does. God fed Elijah by sending him some ravens. Jesus caused a fish to spit out his tax money. And you're worried about where your finances are going to come from? Amen. Jesus healed the blind. He healed the deaf. He healed the lepers, the crippled, and demon-possessed. Jesus has all kinds of miracles for you. And I just want to stir up your faith. Amen. So to do that, I think that faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing the Word of God. So will you just walk through the Bible with me a little bit? Let's turn, you're in Job. I hope you found it by now. Job 5, verse 9. And then we're just going to look at five or six scriptures together. I'm doing this for you either to write it down or for you to open your Bible, and I hope you underline and circle the things that we're pointing out so that you can take it home and you can begin to meditate on these scriptures and start praying these scriptures over you and your family. Amen. Job 5, 9 says this, "But if I were you, I would appeal to God. I would lay my cause before him. He performs wonders that cannot be fathomed, and he performs miracles that cannot be counted." Listen, God can perform miracles and wonders that we can't even fathom. I think about that scripture that says he can do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. We're asking here, but God is thinking up here. Amen. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard the things that he has planned for you. And so we're going to appeal to God tonight in prayer. At the end, I'm not going to preach this long because I want us to spend some time in prayer to usher in these miracles. Amen. And we're going to pray for you. Turn over to Psalm 77. Let's look at this scripture, Psalm 77, and I'm going to read verses 13 and 14. I hope I don't go too fast for you, but I'm usually reading out of the New International Version. And this psalm says, "Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is as great as our God? Mm-mm-mm. You are the God who performs the miracles. You display your power among the peoples." I want you to hold up your hand right now, and I want you to say, "Thank you, Father, for displaying your power in my life, in my family's life, on my job, in my health, in my finances, in my relationships, in the name of Jesus." Amen. Can you turn over to Psalm 90? Let's just flip over to Psalm 90. Now, I am going to read this out of the Passion Version. Sarah Moses gave this scripture to me today, and I said, I've got to slip it into my sermon. Psalm 90, verses 15 to 17. Now listen to this. "We have been overwhelmed with grief. Come now, Lord, and overwhelm us with gladness. Replace our years of trouble with decades of delight." Now I'm going to start praying that right now. Father, replace our years of trouble with decades of delight. And then he says, "Let us see your miracles." You see, they are praying for miracles. "Let us see your miracles again. And let this rising generation see the glorious wonders that you are famous for." Hallelujah. That's just powerful. Amen. God wants to do miracles. He wants to do miracles like he did in the past. And he's not going to leave out our generation when there are believers who are praying for and expecting the miracles of God. Amen. And you see, your children need to see the miracles of God. They need to experience the miracles that God has done for you and for past generations. And I believe that our children are going to see notable miracles. They're going to experience notable miracles in their lives. Okay, flip on over to Mark 6, Mark chapter 6, verse 2. This is talking about Jesus. And it says, "When the Sabbath day came, Jesus began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him, they were amazed, and they said, 'Where did this man get these things? What's the wisdom that has been given him? What are these remarkable miracles that he is performing?'" I just declare over you right now that God has remarkable miracles for you. Remarkable miracles. Say remarkable miracles. See, I want you to see it in the Bible for yourself. You may have been sick for a long time, but God wants to heal you. Amen. You may feel like you're stuck in your life, but I want to tell you, you're not going to remain stuck. God wants to give you a miracle. You may feel like you've been struggling with an addiction for a long time and you can't shake it, but I'm telling you right now, God has a miracle for you. He can set you free tonight. Amen. Amen. Miracles don't stop. Miracles didn't stop when Jesus left the earth. If you get on in the book of Acts, and you can turn to Acts chapter 19, because I want to read this scripture to you. When you get into the book of Acts, miracles continue because Jesus left the Holy Spirit on this earth. The same Holy Spirit that was with Jesus is with us, and he's still doing miracles, and he wants us to do the works that he did. Amen. And this scripture in Acts 19:11 is about the Apostle Paul. And it says, God did extraordinary miracles. There we go, another type of miracle. Extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Let me tell you something. This is on my heart. This may not be you here. It may be someone watching. But evil spirits can get a hold of you. If you just give in to sin and if you give in to wickedness, they can get a hold of you. But I'm here to tell you, God can set you free. And he can set you free tonight in the name of Jesus. See, God, Jesus, when he was on this earth, he cast out demon spirits. And I'm telling you, you don't have to live with that demonic tormenting of your mind or your body or any area of your life. There is no demon that can keep you from the presence of Jesus. Amen. No demon that can keep you from the presence of Jesus. Amen. Let's see where I am now. Okay, turn over to my last scripture, 1 Corinthians 12:28, and then I'm going to give you some points. 1 Corinthians 12:28. Now, this scripture is talking about, is the Apostle Paul also talking about what God has placed in the church. And you know, when the Bible talks about the church, it's not necessarily talking about the local church. We are a church, but it's talking about the body of Christ as a whole. It's talking about every believer who believes in Jesus. And so we are the body of Christ. We are the ecclesia, the Bible says, the called out ones. And so when it says the church, that means you. Every time you read about the church, just remember that is me. I'm a part of the church. And so the Apostle Paul is showing us what Jesus placed in the church, what we should see in the church, what we should experience in the church. And so it says, and God has placed in the church, say in the church, first of all apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then what's the next one? Miracles. Then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. Now, every gift and everything that is in the church is so important, but I want you to see that God actually placed miracles in the church. It should just be an ordinary happening for the body of Christ, for believers. We should pray for the sick. We should cast out demons. We should see God do miracles in our lives. Amen. And so let's just start exercising our faith for more miracles. That's my challenge to you. That's what I'm going to start praying. Let's exercise our faith for more miracles. Now, I noticed just in studying some of the miracles of the Bible that there are some similarities. And I want to point out four of those and just quickly, and then we're going to pray. Many miracles in the Bible occurred, number one, because someone had faith for a specific miracle. I mean, that person had faith. He or she was determined to get a miracle, and they would not take no for an answer. I think I might have to take a little bit of water. Let me just take a sip and hand it back to my dress. Okay. Thank you, my lovely assistant. Okay. But there are similarities. So let me start over. Number one, someone had faith for a miracle. They were determined to get their miracle. They would not take no for an answer. How many of you are like that tonight? You're not going to take no for an answer. Listen, there were two blind men in Matthew 20, and they kept yelling out to Jesus, calling out to Jesus. They wanted to get his attention, and they were determined to get his attention, but everyone around them kept saying, shut up, be quiet, leave him alone. But you know what? That didn't bother them, because faith is not stopped by what people say. Amen. Faith doesn't get discouraged because of what's happening around them. And so they continued to yell out, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. God, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And they got Jesus' attention. And when Jesus saw them, he turned around, and the Bible says that he had compassion upon them. Let me tell you something. Jesus is a God of compassion. And right now, he has compassion on what you're going through. And he loves you, and he knows every detail of your life. And when he looked at them, he had compassion upon them. And he touched them, and he said, receive your sight. And they were immediately healed, and they followed Jesus, the Bible says. You see, they went after their miracle, and they got their miracle. They did not let anything or anyone stop them. Let me tell you something. Faith is daring to believe what others will not believe. Faith is willing to step out of your comfort zone and do something out of the ordinary, maybe even a little crazy sometime. But you're willing to do it. You're willing to be embarrassed in front of people because you have faith in God that he will hear you and he will touch you and you will get a miracle. Amen. I think about another notable miracle, the woman with the issue of blood. I just want us to study some of the miracles tonight. She was forbidden to be among public crowds because of her condition. She was considered unclean. There were so many people around Jesus. She didn't know how she would get to him, but the Bible says she pressed through the crowds. She was determined to get through to Jesus. And she kept saying to herself, if I can just touch his clothes, I don't even need to touch Jesus. I don't even need him to look at me. I don't even need him to pray for me. If I can just touch his clothes, I know I will be healed. Woo, that's faith. That's faith right there. And as soon as she touched Jesus, the Bible says power flowed out of him. And she was healed. Your faith pulls on the power of God. It pulls on the power of God. There's a scripture in Matthew 13, 58. You don't need to turn to it, but it's very telling. And the Bible says that Jesus could not do many miracles in his own hometown because of their lack of faith. Can I just tell you that Jesus goes where the faith is? He just goes where he hears the cry of faith. Where he hears the prayer of faith, where he hears the expectancy. Hey, he's not going to be hanging around unbelief. Jesus goes where the faith is. The Bible says that Jesus left his hometown because they did not believe, and he went to Galilee where the people welcomed him. You see, Jesus is going to show up where he's welcomed. Where he is celebrated, where he is believed, where he is expected to move. Amen. And God is going to move in this place tonight. I'm telling you, we're going to see miracles tonight. I just declare it. I believe it. God is doing something in our midst, and it's starting tonight. It is starting tonight in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. A lack of faith ties the hands of God, but faith moves God to act. Listen, if we don't think about miracles or pray for miracles or expect them, we will not see them. And this is a place that believes in miracles. I know that. We pray for miracles all the time. But I think God is stirring us up to say, I got more on the menu. I've got more miracles for you. I want to show you my wonderful power, my remarkable power. Number two, we're talking about some of the common characteristics of miracles in the Bible, and many times they occurred after an act of obedience. See, an act in the natural seems to always precede a supernatural act. Your action or your obedience in the natural brings about a supernatural act of God. For instance, God told Moses, you're going to have to hold up the rod, and when he did that, the Red Sea parted. The prophet told the destitute single mother of two boys to gather up as many jars as she could. And not even knowing why. Why was she gathering up these jars? She didn't have oil. She only had a little bit of oil. But she did it anyway. It was an act of obedience. And God filled all the jars with oil so that she and her children, her boys, could live on the profit from the sale of the oil. But it was her act of obedience, not even knowing why, that God gave her a miracle. John 4 tells about a royal official who approached Jesus saying, "My son is sick." And he begged him, the Bible says he begged him, "Please come to my house. Please come to pray for and heal my son. He's almost close to death." But you know what? The interesting thing is Jesus didn't go. He didn't go. And let me tell you something. God doesn't always do things the way we want him to, or the way we have in our mind that he's going to do them. And we have our plan, but God's plan is better. And so sometimes he's requiring faith of us. Sometimes he's requiring an act of obedience from us. And so instead he said to this man, "I won't go to your house, but you can go, for your son lives." And so this father had to go home, knowing that his son was close to death, knowing that Jesus wasn't going to come with him, but he had to go home in faith, trusting that Jesus told him the truth. And when he got there, when he arrived home, he found his son, listen, was healed, not just any old time. He was healed at the very moment Jesus spoke it out. Listen, if Jesus says it, he will do it. If Jesus says it, he will do it. Number three is this. Miracles in the Bible occurred many times when someone brought a person to Jesus. God wants you to be someone's miracle. I think about the four men who brought the paralyzed man to Jesus. Remember that story? They couldn't get in through the door because it was so crowded. They were so determined to get their friend to Jesus. And so they decided to cut a hole in the roof. And they just, in the middle of Jesus speaking, they just drop him down gently right into the presence of Jesus. If you can just get into the presence of Jesus, you can get anything you want. I'm telling you, God will touch you. And so when they dropped him down, Jesus touched him. That paralyzed man was completely healed. But it's because his four friends brought him to Jesus. God wants to use you to tell people about his miracle working power, about his healing power. Be a miracle to someone. Lay your hands on the sick. You have the power in you. You are a carrier of God's power. And bring them to church. Bring them to church and let them get saved, healed. Let them experience the miracle for themselves. Amen. Number four is this. God reveals himself in a special way through miracles. I'm going to explain what I mean. God wants you to know him in that miracle. He wants you to know his character and his goodness. When I was born with a crippling disease and the doctors told my parents that I would never walk or talk, my parents prayed for a miracle. But let me tell you something. It was a step of faith for them because they only knew Jesus as their Savior. They had never done this before. They were just learning about Jesus. And so when they stepped out of faith and said, "God, we believe you're a healer. If Jesus healed in the Bible, he'll heal us today." And they prayed for me. And you know the story. God completely healed me within a few months. But let me tell you what happened. My parents had a revelation through that miracle that Jesus is not only our Savior, but he is our healer, and he is a miracle worker. Amen. And they began to tell others, and that's what it's all about, telling others. Amen. When the Israelites needed water, God told Moses to, they were at the place called Marah. They named it Marah, which means bitter, but the waters were bitter, and they needed to drink water so badly. And God told Moses, he said, "Get that tree." He pointed out a tree, throw it into the water. And when he threw the tree into the water, the bitter waters became sweet. I mean, we can learn so much from that. God can take the bitter part of our lives and make them sweet. But this is the revelation that Moses got. He began to declare, if we obey the Lord, he will heal us. And he will take away our sicknesses and what the diseases that were on the Egyptians will never come up on us. For I have seen in this place that he is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Oh, he learned that Jesus was the one who heals, our Jehovah Rapha. In 2 Kings 5, it records another great miracle. Naaman was a Gentile man from Syria, but he had leprosy. He was actually an enemy of the Jews, and he worshiped the god named Rimmon, the Bible says. But he had a servant girl, a Jewish girl, that he had taken captive. And she lived with him and she served with him and his family. And when she learned of his leprosy, did I tell you he had leprosy? I don't know if I told you he had leprosy. Okay, I'm getting off my story a little bit. When she learned of his leprosy, she said, I know a prophet. I know a prophet named Elijah, and he is said to have done miracles. And so Naaman made a visit to Elisha, but it's so funny because Elisha didn't even come to the door when he came to his house. And he just told his servant, he said, tell Naaman to go dip in the Jordan River 7 times and he will be healed. Well, that frustrated Naaman. You know, he thought, you know, I came all this time and all this way and the prophet's not even going to talk to me himself. He didn't even come to the door and he told me to go duck in a muddy river, you know. And I mean, I'm the captain of the army. But, you know, his servants with him said, hey, they had to calm him down. And they said, Naaman, if he would have told you to do something hard, you would have done it. What does it hurt? What does it hurt? Do what the prophet said. And so he calmed down and he went into that muddy Jordan River and he went down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the 7th time he came up completely healed of that leprosy. But let me tell you something. Naaman needed to be more than healed. He needed to know that it's not the prophet that heals, but it's God who heals. And he also needed to know that there is only one true God, and that is the Lord God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And when he was healed, he went back to Elisha humbly, and he said, please let me gather dirt from this place because I want to remember this place, and I will now, from this moment on, I will only worship your God. I will only worship the Lord God. I will only sacrifice to the Lord God, and I will sacrifice to no other God. You see, Naaman met God in that miracle. God revealed himself to him. God not only wants to do miracles for you, he wants to reveal himself to you as your provider, as your healer, as your restorer, as your deliverer, and as your savior. And listen to this. The miracle is not just for you. It's to preach a message. It's to tell others what God can do for them. Amen. I told you I was going to preach a little shorter. Because you know what? I want to spend some time in prayer. I'm serious about spending some time in prayer. I believe this. Some things are only ushered in through prayer. God wants to do it, but until we take a hold of it and believe it and begin to pray about it, you know, things won't happen like he wants them to. And so we are going to spend some time in prayer. But first, let me give an altar call. Would we bow your heads just a moment? Every eye closed, every head bowed, because I want to just talk to you, even those of you who are watching online. And I want to ask you a personal question. If you died right now, do you know where you will spend eternity? Have you ever asked Jesus to come into your life? Do you have peace with God? Have you ever prayed the salvation prayer? You can do that tonight. Or maybe you're here tonight and you would say, or watching and you would say, you know, I really have known Jesus and served him at one time, but I've been far from him. I ran from him. I've been away from him. I've been in sin and I'm sorry for my sin. And I want to rededicate my life to the Lord. I want to get in on that prayer. Maybe that's you. I'm going to ask you to pray with me in just a moment. If you're here tonight in this congregation and you say, Lisa, I want to pray the salvation prayer for the first time, or I want to rededicate my life to the Lord, hold your hand up all over the congregation. All over the congregation. I'm looking around in the middle. Amen. Looking over to my left. Do I see any hands over to my left? I see that. I see that. Amen. I'm going to give you just a moment. If you're watching online, I just want you to know that when you pray this prayer, God is going to forgive your sins. Jesus is going to come into your heart. He's going to be your Lord and Savior. He's going to remove your sins away from you. And no longer will He look at you as a sinner. He will look at you as His treasured child. And He will take care of you and He will watch over you. And He has a plan for your life. Let's pray this prayer together. Say, dear God, I come to you right now. I admit I'm a sinner. And I repent of my sins. Jesus, I ask you to come into my life. I want you to be my Lord. I want you to be my Savior. I receive your forgiveness. I thank you that you cleanse me from all of my sin. I thank you, God, that you're now my Heavenly Father. I belong to you. I'm your child. You have a plan for me. And I ask you, Father, to set me free from any bondages that I may have right now. I can't do it without you, but I know you can help me. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give them a good hand clap. Thank you. Congratulations. Listen, the ushers have a book for you. I know they've already been handing them out, but just come back and let us encourage you, pray with you, teach you. If you give us a year of your life will never be the same. And for those of you who prayed online, listen, write us, email us, let us know on Facebook that you accepted the Lord. And we're going to be praying for you, and we know that your best days are ahead. Amen. Got the worship team up here with me. You know, before we pray, can we just stand and let's worship just a second, not a long time. And then I'm going to have some people up here, and we're going to pray over your finances. We're going to pray over your children. We're going to pray over everything. We're going to cover it, and we're going to call in the miracles. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor
Lisa was saying that tonight is going to be a great move. How many of you believe that the Lord is moving in this place?
Yeah. Come on, all over the building, just raise your hands and say, God, we're ready for a move.
Ready
for you to move by your Spirit.
We are here for you. Come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. We set our hearts on you. Come and
Father, for your miracles. Father, we just call upon you as a body, as a church. And Father, we say we hear your voice. We receive what you want to do, Father. And we want to pray in. and usher in the miracles, every miracle that you have for us, Father. We're going to pray it in, Father. We're going to declare it, and we thank you that we're going to walk in it. I just thank you, Father, that we will see notable, unprecedented, remarkable, extraordinary miracles, Father. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, for it. We praise you, Jesus. Amen and amen. You can sit down if you want to. I'm going to ask my friend Deborah to come up first. Yeah, go on and sit down if you want to. In fact, because you can remain standing if you have a financial need or if you really need a miracle in your finances. Because I want to pray for you. We're going to believe that we're going to see a shift and a change and that God is going to move. And I was telling Deborah about what was on my heart. And I said, I want you to pray over the finances. But first, I want you to, Deborah, tell them what God spoke to you because it was so powerful.
Well, I believe that March is our month for great miracles. Great miracles. And God placed it on my heart that March is miracles. April will be a month for great access. Doors that have been closed are about to be open. March, April, then May, I believe what God placed in my heart, it'll be a month for money, money, money. That supernatural financial blessings are coming our way. So, Father, right now, we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus that, Father, that financial miracles are coming into our lives and into our families. Father, we do declare in the mighty name of Jesus, debt-free living, Father. Father, we thank you that supernatural checks are coming in the mail. That, Father, as Pastor Lisa so powerfully ministered tonight, that unusual miracles will take place in our finances. Father, we thank you. Houses are being paid off. Cars are being paid off. Tuitions are being paid off. Credit cards are being paid off. And, Father, we want to thank you that all of your people, my Father, will have an abundance of finances. And Father, we are expecting our financial miracle in Jesus' name. And everybody shout it.
Amen and amen, amen. Remarkable miracles in your finances. I'm going to ask Pastor Craig Johnson to come up, and you may be seated. But if you have children that you're really concerned about. Well, first of all, can I say this? If you have a special needs child or children, would you stand up first? Because we're going to pray for y'all. Amen. Amen. Pastor Craig and Samantha have Connor, and he's special needs, although he's doing better and better. But I told him, I said, I don't want to just pray for the children. I want to pray for the special needs children because I believe God wants to do remarkable miracles in their lives. I believe he wants them to live a normal life and that God, from this moment on, you're going to see changes in your children, changes for the good, and they're going to become more independent. That's what I just felt the Lord was saying. And so we're going to pray for your children. Now, if you're concerned about a child, we're also going to pray for your children. So stand up. Maybe they're away from God. They need help. They're going through something. I don't know. It could be an addiction, an eating disorder. I don't know what it is. You just stand for them. And Pastor Craig, we're going to believe for miracles.
I do want to say this real quickly. Sometimes, and I know this with my son, you learn to cope with things. And you cope so long that you stop believing for it. And God's saying tonight, I want you to begin to believe again. I want you to step out in faith again. Father, right now, I just pray for each and every one right now, God. I pray for these special needs parents. You know what they're walking through. You know what they're going through. I'll never forget, Lord, when Mama Dodie came to me in 2008 and she said, It was August 20th, 2008. She said, Greg, I believe Connor is going to be healed in Jesus' name. And I stand in faith today believing that he is going to be healed. And every child, every person, every mother, father here with a special needs child, teen, or adult, God, you are going to do a miracle in their life, that things are going to shift. Things that were hard are going to become easier now, Father. Things, Lord Jesus, they've tried to work through, they've coped with, Father, for so long. If they'll step out in faith, you said if we have the faith of a mustard seed, Father, you can move mountains in our life. Father, we're needing some mountains to be moved in our life tonight. I pray for mothers and fathers that their children, Father, went away from you. They're struggling right now, Father. God, you're bringing them back. They're running back home, Father, in Jesus' name. God, what's impossible for man is not impossible with you. Is anything too hard for you, God? And I'm believing for a miracle-working God to bring healing to homes, to bring children back home. And Father, that the lame will walk, that the minds will be restored. And God, we will see children, teens, and young adults, Father, come to you. And Father, they're going to proclaim and they are going to testify of the miracles that's taken place in their life. In Jesus' name, amen and
thank
amen.
Father, I thank you that the enemy's lies and bondage is broken over our children tonight. And Father, I declare that this, from this moment on, they're going to look to you. They're going to have a desire for you. They're going to have a desire for the things of God and for the Word of God. And they're going to even say, I got to get back in church. I got to get back in church. And Father, I thank you that they will just flee evil, Father. They will flee the things of the world, Father. And Lord Jesus, that you would just separate them from the wrong people, Father. And I declare on this night, March 6th, Father, that our children will serve you all the days of our lives. That they will not only serve you, Father, but they will do great and notable things in your kingdom, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, I declare them blessed, Father. I declare them blessed, Father. Blessed and serving God in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. You may be seated. I'm going to ask Deidre to come up and pray. And you don't need to stand for this. I don't want to embarrass anyone. But first of all, I just want Deidre to pray over our marriages. And I want her to pray over hurting marriages. And then just throw in the single people. Let's pray over the single people.
Amen.
God's going to bring in some husbands and wives.
Bring them in. Bring
yes,
in the harvest,
let's
God.
Pray for them all.
Woo. Father, we just praise you tonight for being awesome. Lord, we know that you can do anything, God. We know that there is nothing too hard for you. So, Lord, in this moment, we thank you for moving on marriages, God. Those that have just begun their journey in marriage, we're talking about the newlyweds, 2 years and under. But those that didn't necessarily get all of the tools before they got married, we pray right now, God, that you would give them what they need from this point on, Lord. That you would send laborers to them, give them the information and the wisdom and the knowledge that they need. And Lord, we just cast down every negative statement that's been spoken over marriages about how old marriages will never work, God. In the name of Jesus, we just pray right now that we just reverse those curses that have been spoken and released over marriages, and we decree we declare that your marriage is blessed and that there is unity in your relationship. And Lord, we pray that where there's been wounds and where there's been bitterness and unforgiveness, God, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that they would begin to just let it go. Just let it go and receive the forgiveness, God, and let that healing flow in each and every relationship. And God, and I pray right now that every generational curse that has come through the bloodlines of families, that the separation and divorce, Lord, we just cancel it right now in the name of Jesus. And we pray right now that you would bless our marriages to be able to shift and to break that pattern in the name of Jesus and cause us to be flourishing in our relationships. And Lord, and we know that the enemy only fights the marriages because he knows that the marriages are an earthly example of what the relationship is like between you and the Christ and you and the body of Christ. So God, we rebuke him. We command that you loose your hold. We command that you cease and desist. distance from your maneuvers. And right now, in the name of Jesus, we rejoice in advance for a complete turnaround and healing in these marriages. We will not settle for anything less, because we know that you have already done it. And we praise you and we bless you right now. And for those that are single and they've been believing and they've been praying and they've been waiting, God, we call forth the husbands in the name of Jesus. We call forth the wives in the name of Jesus. The men and women that serve you, that honor you, that have a good job as the husband in the name of Jesus. Those that have provision, God, and those that will be compatible with each other and they'll be able to walk together and agree in the name of Jesus. The scripture says, how can two walk together unless they agree? So we speak agreement over the relationships in the name of Jesus. Release, release, release the blessing. Release the favor of God in the name of Jesus. Let the women be found by their husbands in the name of Jesus. And Lord, remove every counterfeit person, every wrong relationship, God, destroy, break it up, and bring the real thing in the name of Jesus. God, we give you praise. God, we give you honor. And we give you the glory, because we know that you're an awesome God and that you are performing miracles in our midst. Come on and lift up a praise right where you are.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Deidre. Hallelujah. I want to pray for the sick. I want to ask you, is there anyone here with a tumor in your body? That was on my heart today. Tumor. Stand up if you have a tumor in your body. I want to pray for you. Yes. Yes. Okay, good. I want you, if you can, place your hand on that tumor or on your chest to represent it. Because I know it may not be in a place where it can be seen, but let's pray for everyone. Let's see. I'm just looking around. Okay, I see many people standing. Father, in the name of Jesus, I curse that tumor and I command it to die at the root in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Father, that you will cause it to disappear, Father. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your healing anointing right now that is touching them and surging through their body in the name of Jesus. And I say, be healed in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You may be seated. You let us know. I believe those tumors are going to go down. If you're sick in any part of your body, listen, healing is the children's bread. Stand up, please. Forgot to say that. Stand up if you're sick in any area of your body. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Put your hand up. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the healing anointing right now that is present, Father. Thank you, Father, for your healing anointing that is touching people, healing people, driving out sickness and disease, correcting that which needs to be corrected, Father, renewing organs, Father, healing chronic pain in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father, that the pain has to go in Jesus' name. I thank you that the migraines have to go in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father, that you're healing blood, somebody's blood. There's something wrong with your blood, and God is healing you in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet, they are healed. And I declare over them that they are strong and that they are healthy and that you are renewing their strength and their energy, and they will live a long, healthy life, Father. Thank you that you're healing someone in their legs, Father. Their legs hurt, Father. I thank you that you're healing their legs, Father, and that pain is going and they're not going to have that anymore in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, for it. We thank you, Father. Praise you, Jesus. We thank you for your healing anointing. And I declare that you're healed by the stripes of Jesus. By the stripes of Jesus. You may be seated. You may be healed also. You know, Craig, I think I'm going to call you back up to pray about this, because I know there are things that we haven't touched and maybe we don't know about, but how many of you are in a court case or in a situation right now that's being decided and you need the favor of God, I want you to stand up. And amen. Let's pray over that, Craig. Or maybe you just need favor in any area. You just need favor. Maybe it's favor on your job or something that's just not quite right. You're not being treated right. And God wants to move. He wants to move people out, number one. He might have to move people out, and I'm talking about the other people. And he can vindicate you, and he can bring restoration in your life. But I believe that God is going to give you favor, the favor that you need to turn the situation. He'll cause the judge or the mediator or whoever, the boss, to favor you. In Jesus' name, let's pray.
Father, first of all, I pray over every mind right now that's going through a struggle, because it might be a legal struggle. It might be a struggle in their job. What you have not given them a spirit of fear, but you've given them a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind. And that, God, they can rest in that peace, that you are going to work for them right now in their situation, God. It seems impossible right now, God. It seems like all the obstacles are against them. But, Father, it's for those who believe, God, tonight, that you can change those situations. You can change the lawyer's mind. You can change the judge's mind. You can turn any type of situation around, Father. God, we're believing that, God, you are going to restore situations that seem to be impossible and lost right now, Lord God. We believe, God, you're going to go into job situations, Lord. And Father, where there is opposition, where there is constant struggle, Lord Jesus, where there seems to be no way out of this situation, God, you're going to completely and totally turn that situation around, and you are going to, Lord God, not only bless it, but you're going to, God, promote it in Jesus' name. You're going to give them promotion, God. They're going to be blessed beyond what they thought could be possible. And Father, we believe it is done, God, not by might, not by power, but by your Spirit, God. We believe it's done in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Hallelujah. You're going to have unusual favor. Unusual favor. I'm not just talking about those who stood, all of you. You're going to have unusual favor. You're going to see it even this week. You're going to see something happen, and it's going to be notable. And you're going to know it's because you came to church on Wednesday night, and you cried out to God, and he heard your prayer. And he's saying, I'm going to reward you. I'm going to do it for you. I'm going to give you remarkable miracles. Yes, thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, let's go out of here worshiping God. Let's just, when this worship song, we're going to sing in Jesus' name. And when it's over, you're dismissed. I love you, and let's believe for the miraculous.